Hello, everyone. My name is Ellsworth Gerrels. I'm a rocket scientist, better known as a space jockey, comes from America. And I was fortunate, first of all, I want to tell you, I am a Christian. And maybe that's unusual among some scientists, but it's not where I come from. We believe in God, and I believe that God created everything that exists, including the Earth, the solar system, the great, awesome universe, and life itself. I thought that maybe I could convince you a little bit more that there is a God, and this God is a powerful God and created everything. I wanted to mention that the objectives of many of the space programs that we have and the Russians have had are to determine the origin of the universe and the origin of life. And we've been studying this for a long time, since about 1960. Sent many spacecraft into the sky and visited almost every planet of our solar system and studied some extensively, like Mars. And of course, as you know, we also had men on the moon. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that. In the Bible, I believe the Bible is true. And in the Bible, the first verse in the Bible is in Genesis 1. And it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." And then it goes on to say some more, and I'll come back to that. An atheist doesn't believe in God, and so therefore, they don't believe that anybody created the earth and the heavens. It had to be initiated and created by itself. It had just by chance. I first wanted to show you my beautiful picture of the earth. This was taken on the way to the moon back in 1968. And the earth is a fantastic planet. It is built so beautifully that there are some 74 parameters on the earth itself that if changed whatsoever, there would be no life on planet earth. These parameters are such as, the distance from the earth to the moon, the moon's rotation about the earth, the atmosphere of our earth, the temperature of the sun, the distance from the sun to the earth. There are 74 of those, and they're so vitally important, and everything must be there. If you modify that any considerable amount at all, we would have no life on the earth as we know it. I found a scripture about 6 months ago that I really like, and I added this to my talk. By the way, I give these talks around the world when I'm asked, and I've been to Russia now. This is my second time. E.Gerrels was with me then. This verse really tells it. And it says, "For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself formed the earth and made it. He established it. He created it not in vain." Wasn't you futile? "He formed it to be inhabited." Well, that's the verse that really got me. God formed the earth to be inhabited. That's why we're living here. "And I am the Lord, and there is none else." And that was written way back in the book of Isaiah, some nearly 3,000 years ago. So I think that's special. On our way to the moon, one of the early shots we took was that of the earth shine. The sun was shining up above, reflected on the ocean, and then shone back into the camera. It's not moonshine, it's the earth shine. And you can see here that the atmosphere of the earth, which is about 150 miles deep, is shown by the blue line right across there. If that atmosphere wasn't there, we wouldn't live. And you can also see the curvature of the earth in that picture. Then when we got to the moon in 1968, Frank Borman was the commander of the spacecraft. And as they orbited the moon about 60 miles above the surface in a small spacecraft, they came up on the moon, looked at it like we would be on the earth, and then look at the Earth like we look at the Moon. And this spacecraft, Apollo 8, was designed to go around the Moon, orbit it, and look at the sites We had sent many spacecraft up there before, also to evaluate possible landing sites and also to evaluate the characteristics of the moon before we sent man there, because we wanted to prevent any accident. So this is the Earth from the moon. The stars don't show because the light in the foreground is so bright on a camera, it dissolves the bright dots of the stars. Now, Frank Borman was a Christian, one of the few astronauts we had that was a professing Christian. And he brought his Bible along. That was on December the 25th, 1968, Christmas Day. And he read this from his Bible, found in the book of Psalms. Remember, Psalms was written well over 2,000, by almost 3,000 years ago. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth, who has set your glory above the heavens. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, and the moon, which he was orbiting about, and the stars which you have ordained, what is man, little old ordinary man, that you are mindful of him, such a small part of his universe, and the Son of Man, that you visit him? He sent Jesus down to the earth, see, to visit man. And why would we be so important? It's a marvelous scripture back there in 1968. Apollo 11, you probably heard about the Apollo program. I had an intimate part of the Apollo program. And the Apollo Saturn V launch vehicle, which is shown here, it is the largest launch vehicle ever made. 7.5 million pounds of thrust. That means you can lift 7.5 million pounds off the surface of the Earth. Now, maybe I should mention that in kilograms, but it changes my thought a little bit, so I'll just stick with the English units. The three men in the command module, as they went to the moon, are located right in this small command module right here. Three men inside there. The rocket is as tall as a 35-story building. It's that tall. And it was launched on July 16th. And in 3 days, we were on the surface of the moon. It's July 19th. First time ever, and I thought I would show you a picture that you've seen before, the first step on the moon. That's Neil Armstrong's step. We photographed it. They did. Buzz Aldrin was with him. Two men go from the spacecraft down into the surface of the moon, and the other man, that's the three-man command module, orbits the moon and watches while they're down working on the lunar surface of the moon. Then later on, they start their ascent engines and come up into space, and at 60 miles, they have to reach the command module. They dock, transfer, and then go back to Earth. So it's not a simple thing. This kind of brings up the question. We were concerned about the height of the dust on the lunar surface. Theoretically, if it was there for a long time, it could have caused dust as much as, one-third of a meter. And if that was the case, the retro rockets of our spaceship coming down would have made a big cloud of dust, and the astronauts could not have seen where they wanted to land their vehicle. So before we put these men up there, we had sent several spacecraft and other objects to measure the characteristics of the moon, including the amount of dust that's on the surface. And we found out that the dust was only, about 2 or 3, 4 inches high. And you can see on this picture how they sunk into the soil. So it would stir up. We had a successful launch. Let's see here. This is Buzz Aldrin in his spacesuit. Now, I'd like to ask you, if you knew, could you explain to me why the astronauts, when they're in zero gravity and in no air, no vacuum, there's a perfect vacuum, why do they have to wear a spacesuit? Why do most astronauts, cosmonauts also, wear a spacesuit? Well, I'll tell you. First of all, the sun on the moon is unobscured by any atmosphere. So it is as hot as plus 250 degrees Fahrenheit on this side where the sun is shining. And because there's no air, no convection forces can take the energy, the hot temperature from here and transfer it over there. So it can be as low as a minus 250 degrees on this other side. That means a 500 degree temperature differential. He would burn on one side and freeze on the other. So we prevent that by this backpack. The backpack has fluid in it that circulates around his spacesuit, kind of a bulky thing, and cools him to about 80 degrees. That backpack also provides oxygen to breathe. There is no oxygen on the moon, and the backpack gives him oxygen. And also, because there's a pure vacuum on the moon, if he would rip his spacesuit, and this is a very important thing, we don't want the astronauts to play games and bounce around and fall and cut a big gap in their gas in their spacesuit. If they would, if they wouldn't get it fixed in time, and that's a very short period of time, he would open his body up to pure vacuum, and the blood would boil and he would explode. So men would die very rapidly if they cut their spacesuit any significant amount. So the spacesuits are very important. They're cumbersome. You can't sit your watch very good with that on. But anyway, the other thing I'd like to show you is for every mission, we had six missions, two men each, that landed on the surface. So we had 12 men on the surface of the moon between 1969 and 1972. Now, every place we landed, those six missions, we put up a flag. And the reason for it is not to show that America conquered that soil, because we're not intending that whatsoever. But we wanted to mark the spot where man first landed on the moon and the next time and so forth. So that's a flag. And I remember 9 years ago when I was talking to some high school students and some college students here in Korsk, they raised their hands and they said, "We were told that America never put men on the moon." And well, wow, really? Well, yeah. So he said, "Look at the flag. There's no wind on the moon. And you show that the flag is blowing in the wind." Well, we knew that there was no wind in the moon. And if we put that flag in a normal position, the one-third gravity that's on the moon would have draped the flag right down the pole, and you wouldn't have seen it in a picture. So we put wires in the flag, every one of them, all six flags, had wires in it so you can see it. I think that's the main thing. And they were satisfied. I also told them that in the environment we lived, in a free country like America, we had about 100,000 people, men and women, working on Project Apollo for those 8 years. And we had 25,000 to 35,000 press people following us every step we took. Because it's a free press in America, you couldn't have hidden it from him at all. There's no way we could have kept that a secret that Hollywood did it instead of us. So I'll guarantee you, it's not true. Now, we also put some cars on the moon. We have three cars currently on the moon. We left them there because they're too expensive to carry back to America or to the world. In fact, it'd be very difficult because we'd have to build a bigger ascent stage and all that kind of thing. Very, very costly. However, these three cars cost $45 million each. Now, that's an expensive convertible, and of course, we didn't even buy it with a top. But these cars were built so that the astronaut could go further away from their lunar base, because we wanted them to investigate as much of the moon as they could within a timely manner. We only had 2 or 3 days at the most on the surface of the moon, so they had to come back. So these cars gave them that freedom to go and drive around and look at different parts of the moon, at least a few miles away. I think that's it. Oh, you would like to know what speed they come. I like sports cars. So these cars were limited to about 6 kilometers per hour. That's not too fast. But we didn't want them to go too fast, because if you hit a rock, and there are lots of rocks on the moon, the gravity of 1/6 gravity on Earth will bounce them up 6 times higher than you would on the Earth. And it would be, of course, you could tip over, have a terrible accident, slit their spacesuit and die. So we limited the speed they can travel. So, Next picture here shows what they did when it went far out. This happens to be the famous Genesis rock. Even the astronomers call that rock the Genesis rock. We said it's an old rock, and they would chip away and bring the rocks and the soil from wherever they went back to the Earth. So we brought back about 400 kilograms of soil and rock, about 840 pounds of soil and rock, distributed them to universities and museums and research labs and so forth. And Russia, Moscow, I'm sure, has some lunar rock there. And if you look for it, you can ask them where they are, they'll show it to you. You can't touch it because they're precious, because there aren't very many lunar rocks in the world. Okay. Now, after Project Apollo, we put our mind to setting up a space station. But Russia also was interested in a space station, and me being a young engineer, I was involved in designing and looking at the possibilities of large space stations orbiting the Earth. And the reason for space stations is we wanted to learn how a space environment would affect a man in zero gravity, because we didn't know if their bones would decalcify and what they'd have to do to prevent bone decalcification. So when they come back to Earth, they could walk again. So Russia and the United States both sent very early space stations up to determine what handicap it is to have a astronaut in space for, say, as much as a year. And we've done that. We found out that with the right kind of ergonomic equipment, we could foresee staying in space for at least a year, maybe more. The next picture I'm showing you here is the space shuttle. The Apollo Saturn V is a very expensive rocket. And we would like to find a way of sending people and hardware into space more economically. So we worked on design of a space shuttle which was reusable. And the airplane is a part of here. You see it on the news all the time. That's the airplane. That goes back to the Earth with the men in it. And then this is the solid rocket motors. We send those back, except they're empty, so we refuel them. And the rest we dump into the Atlantic Ocean. We have launched 145 of those vehicles, and they are prominent along with Soyuz to furbish the material we need and provide for the International Space Station. Now I'm going to show you a picture of the shuttle being launched. The shuttle, like the Russian vehicles, that's a very noisy and shaky system. If you stand close or get close enough, you'll enjoy the vibration, and you have to plug your ears. Okay. Now I'm going to show you a picture of the International Space Station. That vehicle, that spacecraft, is the largest spacecraft that we, the United States and Russia, and 12 other countries have launched. It's the size of two soccer fields in size. It's powered by solar, and the men live in these habitat modules here. It took about 8 years to completely assemble it into space. It is now operational, fully operational, and it carries as many as 5 to 7 astronauts and cosmonauts at one time. This is a joint program with 14 nations, Russia and the United States being the primary suppliers of the money and the hardware. We don't know how long it'll be up there, because it's a matter of whether it's economically feasible to keep it up or not. But it flies at about 250 miles above the surface of the Earth, and it's so big that if you look at it at the right time at Kursk, at dusk or at dawn, you can look up and see it move slowly across the sky, the brightest star that you will see. And if you want to find out when it's over Kursk, you can go to the computer, internet, and ask for NASA.gov, G-O-V. And then ask for the ISS, that's the International Space Station. And then tell them what city you're from, Kursk, Russia, and the trajectory. And they will tell you what time of the day and what days it will be over Karsk. Then you can be ready to look at it. Hopefully it's not cloudy. This is a picture of two astronauts or cosmonauts repairing or doing some work on a space station. We always use two for safety reasons, in case one has some problems, we can get them back. And of course, this is a picture of the Soyuz launch vehicle. The shuttle might be ending its career by the end of February, but they're currently in debate in our U.S. Congress and with Russia to figure out whether indeed we would continue for a little bit longer. Otherwise, we'll have to rely on Soyuz entirely, and it's not as big a vehicle, so it can't haul large objects, but it can replace the crew and expendables like food and so forth. Originally, we had this design. This big vehicle was under test and development in the United States to replace the shuttle. But right now, because of budgetary problems, the economy and the world, we have temporarily shut that down. But we're wondering whether our government and our Congress, and with Russia's help, we will keep it going, because it would be the next launch vehicle that is much bigger than Soyuz and what we've had before.
While we continue being a benevolent project, your kind donations will continue to be vital in fulfilling the calling of TVS Ministry. We do count on your gracious support and cooperation. For detailed information, visit www.tvseminary.com.
Before we tell you more about what Russia and the United States has done in the exploration of the Earth and its universe, including its solar system, I would like to tell you a little story. Towards the end of the Apollo program, which is such an ambitious program, several of us, including Dr. Werner von Braun, the fellow that we obtained from Germany after the Second World War, had the idea that it would be nice if we could send, while we have all this hardware, we could send 12 men in a spacecraft, upgrading of the Apollo spacecraft, and send them to Mars, and land them, all 12 men, on the surface of Mars by 1985. Now that is an ambitious endeavor. I want you to know that the moon is only 250,000 miles from the Earth. It only takes a day or two to get there, and a round trip you can do in a week. But Mars is up to 200 million miles from the Earth. And instead of a day or two, it will take us a round trip somewhere in the vicinity of 2 years or more to get round trip back to Mars. That means you have to send all the food and water and all that kind of stuff, essentials, along with you on this long, torturous trip. The reliability has to be extremely high. You can't turn around in the middle of the mission. So we studied that and developed some interesting spacecraft, which I do have pictures of, but I won't show them here, and what they might look like. But at that time, about 1973, 74, the world's economy was shrinking, and we decided that we would not do that. It was too costly. It would cost us somewhere in the neighborhood then of about $100 to $200 billion, instead of the $35 to $40 billion it cost on Project Apollo. And so we decided not to do it. By the way, now if you go to Mars, it was, with our day's economies, it would cost us about $400 billion to send a mission to Mars. Not 12 men, but maybe four. So it's a very difficult thing to do, a lot different. For example, it would take you 2 seconds or 1 second to make a telephone call from the Earth to Moon. But it would take you 20 minutes to make a call to Mars. And then if you go out, ask for a response back, like, how are you doing? 20 minutes later after that, they would call back and say, bad, or something, see? So you have no chance of doing much. It had to be an autonomous mission. They had to take care of the problems primarily by themselves. So lots of work to do.
Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 10, 11. How to give to TVS Ministry. You may give online at efta.org/givenow. In the description place, write Russia Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Or make checks out to EFCA. Write on the check memo line, Russian Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Mail to EFCA Donor Services, 901 East 78th Street, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55420-1300. Or send your gift through PayPal for tvs.gift@gmail.com.